I'm 2 days into college and I'm 3 lectures behind. There's this guy, let's name him Colin. He says he wants to be mine, but it doesn't really sit with me quite right, cause he doesn't really like the things I like, and I keep accidentally locking myself out of my dorm in the middle of the night.
This is the 5-Point Play Podcast, the diehard Duke basketball fan podcast. Jared fucking McCain, 35. The guy was absolutely on fire. That was one of the best performances I've seen, not just from a freshman, but from a Duke player in a really, really long time. That was the first time that I got the full-on, since Luke Kennard probably, I got the full-on J.J. Redick vibes. Whatever he threw up there, you just knew it was going in, and it did. He was, 7 of 8 in the first half from three. The guy was just absolutely unconscious. And overall, though, just Duke is starting a three-game road stretch, a game that we really were like, hey, you know, if we're going to be a team that we are trying to be, that's a game you got to have. They played well. They did everything that they needed to do. We got the full roster tonight. We got the full roster of the 5-Point fam. It's good to have everybody back. Honestly, AC, like, you know, we didn't have Tyrese Proctor, and he may be out again on Wednesday against Miami. We'll probably touch on that a little bit, but it starts and ends to me with that Florida State game with Jared McCain.
No, absolutely. I think based on our expectations that we started the season with, I feel like Jared is doing what we expected Reese to do at this point. So if he can continue this, it's difficult for a freshman to continue that type of streak. If he can find a way to continue this and Reese can kind of fill in what we wanted Jared McCain to do, that's all we need. Like, if that's all we need you to do, Reese, just do what Jared did. Like, what we expected from Jared. If you can hit some open shots, help run the offense, get to the bucket when you need to, like, just do your Reese thing. Like, it's a lot to rely on a freshman like that. But at this point, what else are we going to do? Like, we can't keep begging people to step up or whatever. And obviously Reese is injured. He wasn't there, you know, whatever the case may be. But I just feel like Jared's taking that mantle from Tyrese of what we were expecting from him to start the season.
He looked like the best future pro on the floor all game. The three to end the half was just a super smart play. Like, that's crazy smart of a freshman just to gather the ball, one dribble step back. And that was the third step back jumper of the half. So
not only smart, but that's that road confidence that John has wanted from these guys. Like, get on the road and get a road kill, like, shut the crowd up, be the aggressor, be the asshole on the road. And he did that, man. You heard the crowd booing him every time. They were cheering every time he missed a shot. Like, you know what I mean? Like, the dude was trying to fight him. Like, you know what I mean? Like, everything was good. Like, he was in everybody's head, man.
He got body slammed a few times. But we talked about, like, if there was a point guard to go pro after 1 year, it's going to be Foster. I might be changing my mind on that.
It's definitely time to change your mind on that. But to Dee's point there, that play at the end of the half, and I figured we would get to that at some point, but here, let's start with it. Is that, you know, first of all, that play from the pass from Jeremy Roach was filthy, number one. And then the unconsciousness of Jeremy Cain to have a presence of mind with 3-4, you know, seconds left to go to take the one dribble, to step back, knock it down, and then to shush the crowd. He got booed the entire second half every time he touched the ball. That's the villain we need. That's the kind of guy that we've been looking for to see, like, all right, bring it on. Bring it on. We've talked about this, Jack, a million times. The pain in nails, bring it. Like, if you're gonna do it, like, just bring it on. Like you have to come up with something new as an opponent. Like, the pain in nails thing is overplayed now. It doesn't work. The guy has heard this for probably 4 or 5 years. He chose to come to Duke. He chose to come to Duke knowing full well that is just going to make him even more polarizing of a figure. And he has owned it. He's embraced it. And he plays with just an absolute verve that Coach K always used to talk about. And we talked about this in the last podcast, where the three that he hit to kind of basically seal the game at Louisville, and he turned around to the two middle-aged dudes who were chirping at him on the baseline. and, you know, was laughing at him. He was just laughing at him. What I love about Jared McCain's trash talk is that he just laughs at you. Like, that, you can't come back from that because he's hitting threes in your face. He's playing harder than you are, and he's a better player than you are. And what are you going to do? You can't do anything, and he just laughs at you. I love every second of it, Jack. That's why we played the little TikTok intro that, you know, is say whatever it is about it. You can't do anything about it. If you don't like it, shut him up. You can't do it.
I mean, yeah, Jared. I'm going to start by saying that song's been stuck in my head for like 2 weeks now. Thank you, Jared.
It grows on you.
It
does grow on you. I'll tell you that, Paul.
It does. Okay, look. Jared McCain is... I saw someone commented on my Instagram a few weeks ago. I made a post about him, and it was like, this guy posts everything that I would record and make sure no one else ever saw my entire life. And that, I mean, this is a kid who does not care what other people think. He's going to be him. He's going to be his best self, and he does not care what you think. And look at this. He backs it up. He's a cold-blooded killer. Straight up, he's a hooper. I don't want to hear it. I don't care. I don't care what Jared does off the court. You shouldn't care either. That kid's a hooper.
Well, I'll tell you what he does off the court is that he's the hardest worker off the court. And it's not just, you know, putting up shots after games where, you know, some people see that. But he's been the hardest worker the entire summer. John commented about that. He's also the guy that is watching extra film. Give a shout out to TJ Power. I know he's not getting minutes, but he does the same thing. Pablo, I want to bring you in here because, you know, what can other players, not just Duke players, but what can other players learn from a guy like Jared McCain where he comes in here with, you know, a million TikTok followers and he's got like that other side of things, but he's still got the presence of mind to be the hardest worker as well.
So what they can learn, I mean, they can learn work ethic. You know what I mean? When you come in with a work ethic like Jared McCain, you know, what you're going to get is, you know, player empowerment from the coach. And that's what you're seeing. It's just a prime example of, you know, John Shire trusting him. And even when he's not playing well, he still wants him to shoot the ball. And not only to shoot the ball, like open shots, like he wants him to take shots and like hunt shots and take those shots that are backbreakers. So, I mean, that's just bottom line. That's what you see. But that's what Jared McCain is. You know what I mean? He's been like that ever since the first time I watched him. I think he was a seventh or eighth grader playing for the Compton Magic. And he was still living in Sacramento. You know what I'm saying? And he was a chubby kid. You know what I mean? So he was working his ass off, though. So, you know, we see just the product of hard work, man, and just dedication. Mm-hmm. Just a good spirited, you know, player. It's a good human being, too, man. Like, comes from a good family. You know, he's leading the charge for Duke right now. You know what I'm saying? He's looking real elite. And I like what I see, bro.
Yeah.
D brought up a lot last year, real quick. That documentary and I want to let D speak on it because he's the one who talks about a lot. The documentary. Go ahead, D. Talk about the documentary because that was – it reminded me of Paolo. Like, Paolo had some cameras following him when he was in high school and they went through his routine and started at 4 a.m. And you know what I mean? And you see the fruits of that labor. Like, you see what Paolo Banchero has become. Like, D, I know. Go ahead. Run, D.
Yeah, no. Good. Thanks for bringing that up. I mean, like, if anybody's ever seen it, or if you haven't seen it, check it out. Ball is Life, the Jared McCain documentary. It just followed him throughout his time at Centennial. And this kid would wake up at 5 a.m. and do yoga and Pilates. And he would read like the same inspirational, like, quote book that he's been reading for
meditation.
I forgot what it was called, but And then he would drive 3 hours to school, and then he would drive 3 hours for training, and he would drive 3 hours for strength conditioning. I mean, and he loved every minute of it. He never didn't have a smile on his face. He never wasn't saying thank you or, you know, like you said, Paul, great family, great kid, great personality. I mean, I think my dog is choking. Not sure, but are you good now? All right, peace. But no, it just shows what he has been working towards I mean, even the wish wall or the whatever he called it, like he checked all those boxes off. Who in their adult life has done that? This kid has accomplished every goal that he has set for himself.
That wish wall reminded me of when Battier used to have his goals he would set every year. He'd set 10 goals every year and he'd check them off.
Yeah, but I mean, like, you know, the fruits of his labor are coming to fruition in front of our eyes on the floor right now. And his hard work is paying off. And I think it's proven himself correct to where we talk about attitude a lot. You're going to turn the nicest player in the ACC into the villain? Okay, watch out.
Yeah, it's not a great idea. And AC, the one thing I was going to bring up, and I'm glad that you brought up the documentary there to kind of tee up D there. But what I actually thought about was the Jabari Parker. You know, when Jabari Parker was coming in, you know, and they did the three-part Sports Illustrated, and it started way back with Simeon. And, you know, he's going in there before the lights are on, 4 or 5 a.m., putting up shops with his brother and doing that. And that's what it reminded me of. And I know that J.J. Redick had the same thing when you're talking about the list, same with Battier. Now, all those great players, though. We're talking about great players.
But that's what you do if you want to be great.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like, greatness and being elite, like, I think everybody wants that elite tag. They slap the elite tag on everything, basketball, soccer, like, every summer team is something elite. Like, number one, not everybody's elite. Number two, that's – elite is that. Elite's what are you willing – sometimes it's what are you willing to give up. Like, it's not about what are you willing to do. Sometimes it's about what are you willing to sacrifice and what are you willing to give up.
What are you willing to sacrifice? Absolutely.
And he's like D's brought up, he loves the sacrifice. You love it. Like, you love loving the struggle. Is you hear great anybody who's great at anything always talks about loving and embracing the struggle. And if you're willing to get out of that comfort zone and do that, man, then chances are you're gonna be great. So we're seeing it.
Yeah,
I will say two things that are elite: Jared McCain and the 5-Point Play Podcast.
I would argue
that there is plenty of elite talent out there.
But
the elite talent that wants to be great,
right?
I don't think 99% of them have the work ethic to do it.
Yeah, you have to have an elite work ethic and the elite talent to be an elite player.
The thing about it too is that you got to realize that a lot of these kids, man, like, you know, when the camera's in front of them, it's a show. You know what I'm saying? Yep. It's all about the camera. But what are those kids doing when those cameras are not on them? What are they doing when those cameras are off? And that's why you got players like Jared McCain, who, if you really think about it, just from a player standpoint, like, he doesn't have like elite measurements. He's not an elite athlete. He's not really that fast. He's not, if you think about it, he's not really that elite in a lot of areas, you know what I'm saying? Except like his shooting, right? But what makes him so damn good is that he's so fundamentally sound from all the work that he's put in, and he's so intelligent on the court. All that shit translates, man. So that's just he's a typical player. He's a prototype of, you don't have to have these, you don't have to be 6'6 with a fucking 7'2 wingspan and a 48-inch vertical, you know what I'm saying, to be elite and to be a ball player and to be a pro. And that's the thing about Jared McCain. You know what I mean? He's the fucking blueprint. He's the blueprint.
It reminds me of Tyus.
Pound for pound, he might be the strongest player on that team. I just want to say that. I think he could
him and Caleb both. We talked about that in the offseason. Yeah, we talked about that in the offseason, how strong they are. Yeah. No, like what Pablo's saying, it reminds not the same player. I'm not comparing players. It reminds me of Tyus. Tyus is the same thing. No measurables, can't jump, can't run, can't do anything apparently. But he's a first round pick and he's making a living in the NBA because his work ethic is elite and the way he sees the floor is elite. All those things. And Jared's got a gift, man.
Jared McCain looks like he's built like a running back. That's all I'm saying.
What's the old cliche that hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard? Like that to me is exactly what these guys are. The Tyuses, the Jared McCains. But, you know, let's talk about the game overall, because this is a game that Duke, I thought, needed to have. It was, you know, coming off of a three-game home stretch where, we took care of business. We did what we needed to do. I thought it was a really good win at home against Wake Forest. And then we came here, and it's without our starting point guard. They obviously knew before we did that you know, Tyrese was not going to make the trip. I thought overall, while some guys may have not had their best games or things like that, I thought collectively as a whole, Duke played pretty well, and they held it together the game, especially in the second half. Never got under, I think it was 5 points every time Florida State kind of hit a couple. We answered immediately. It wasn't always Jared McCain, because in the second half, it wasn't Jared McCain. It was Jeremy Roach. It was Phil Patterson made some nice moves, some nice plays. I thought Mark Mitchell did some nice things. And I thought, really, your boy Ryan Young, I thought he gave really solid minutes. I really do. I thought that as much as fans, and we'll talk about fans later, but as much as fans want to trash Ryan Young, I thought the stats might not be there, 0-for-2, 2 rebounds, but I thought he gave really strong minutes for Duke.
We talking about Ryan Young?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Him and Blake's, I think, gave really, really good minutes. My one gripe is Duke is getting more and more turnover prone again, where they had cleaned that up in the past. And
17 is too many.
They let a lot of off. I can think of 3 possessions off the top of my head where they gave up at least 2, maybe 3 offensive rebounds. And that's simply not okay. And TK, I do agree with you that Duke, although they let it get close, they were able to keep, you know, make plays to keep, you know, stay ahead of the curve. But that also shows me that they didn't step on their throat and finish it with 14 minutes to go in the second half, which I think is an issue too. Overall, you clean up some of those rebounds issues and the turnover issues, and you get out of there with a nice, easy double-digit win, because Florida State's not easy to beat. They're long, they're lengthy, I'm saying it. They're all 6'10 plus, every starter across the team, and they're going to play 9'10
Not so much this year, though.
Every starter is 6'10 plus.
They still aren't. Pause.
They do. They still keep those 7'2" dudes and stuff, but like they don't have the 6'9" point guard like they used to have and stuff. Like Leonard Hamilton doesn't even run his 1-3-1 on his out of bounds plays anymore. Like he doesn't do anything because
AC real quick.
Those types of defenders.
I want to bring that up.
That's the biggest team in the ACC.
I wanted to bring that up though. I thought once we learned that. And we talked about this on the text that I would have pressed Duke from start to finish in that game, and they picked up full court, but they didn't really press. There was no like tracking. Press, like, our depth, you know, really we go 6, maybe 7 deep in terms of you know how many guys are going to play double digit minutes, right? So. Mm-hmm. And this game kind of showed that as well, except you know Jalen somehow got 10 minutes. Because he played well, you know, but I'm saying
he
that
did
that
play
was
well.
My seventh. But,
he did.
But my point is that, like, you know, if I was Leonard Hamilton, I would have trapped more. I would have forced the issue because he's running 11 guys, you know, double digit minutes.
You know, I think they do have the 6'11 guys. They do have 6'10 guys. Bobby Miller, all those dudes, Bowen. Gainey, all those guys, they all get minutes because he plays his entire team. But
right.
The guys who get the bulk of the minutes and do the bulk of the scoring and stuff for them are really 6'4 and 6'6 guards. They're not the normal, not the exact Florida State we're used to, which was fine this game. But we turn the ball over because that's what they do. They put you in turnover situations. So they did a good job of that. And that's why we couldn't pull away from them, in my opinion, was just we didn't run point guard plays, I guess is the best way to put it. There was a lot of quick hitters. There was a lot of hunting shots, especially for Jared because he was hot. And then Jeremy towards the end and you know, try to get it flipped, some post touches or whatever. But they were doubling flip. They got a lot of the turnovers off of him. They got a couple off Mark. Jeremy dribbled off his foot once or twice. Caleb Foster had a couple of turnovers. Like, you know what I mean? Like, we're just kind of forced into those situations. So, I mean, if anything, you know, it's good to see that we can play against a bigger team and continue to just do what we do. This game wasn't remarkable to me in any way other than what we talked about with Jared. Like, everything else was kind of status quo. Like, it is what it is. I don't think we would have lost that game if Jared didn't have 35, like I've seen online, but because somebody else would have stepped up and scored. But
yeah,
it's nice to have a player like Jared to be able to score like that, especially against a team like Florida State at their gym. Like, that was the biggest takeaway was – I think the upperclassmen can look at that freshman and be like, okay, if he can go into somebody else's environment and do that, I need to go ahead and step myself up too. So we'll see if they respond.
Yeah, go ahead,
Jack. I want to say I agree with what AC said. The whole, like, you know, people are saying, oh, Duke would have lost if not for Jared putting up a record-setting performance. No. I watched yesterday. I had some time, so I watched Danny Ferry's 58-point game. Duke was winning by like 20, and that lead was down to, I think, 5 with a few minutes to go. Duke ended up winning the game by 15, and Danny Ferry had 58 freaking points. Like, that's it was kind of similar. The lead kept getting larger and then getting cut down by a very, very, like, eager Miami team. You know, this is 4 years into their revived basketball program. These are guys that wanted to make a statement against the number one team in the country. It's a little bit different than Florida State right now, but, you know, you get the point. This is one Duke player putting up one of the most insane shooting performances in the history of college basketball. And if Danny didn't do that, that team still wins that game. Having watched it yesterday, that team still wins that game. I don't care that they only won by 15 with Danny putting up 58 points. It's the same thing. The rest of the team would have taken and made those shots. Obviously not at the same clip, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, Pablo, I want to bring you on this because, you know, yeah, I agree with what D said in terms of, yeah, we had 17 turnovers. That's way too many.
Also, sorry, TK, one last thing. 17 turnovers, but 15 of them were by 3 guys. That's another thing to focus on.
Yeah, for sure. And a lot of that was really good. A lot of that goes to what D's saying, and we got to clean a lot of that stuff up. But, Pablo, how did you feel during that game? Because when I was watching that game, I was never concerned. And I think that was more the point that I was trying to make, where I was like, they cut it to 5 a few times, but I was never concerned about losing that game because I just felt like Duke had control and they just weren't going to lose it. I mean, you kind of get that feeling sometimes, and that's kind of how I felt. But where did you kind of stand on that?
Nah, I'm with you. Like, just watching the game, obviously I didn't watch it live because I was out with the family, but just rewatching the game and shit, and I just think that I'm with you on that. I never felt as if Duke was going to lose the game. I did feel towards the end of the game, though, I knew that, you know, you say they weren't pressing or whatever, and I think what they were just trying to do, what Leonard Hamilton was trying to do, was just trying to kill some of the clock from Duke, and they knew that they would have some of their longer players in the game to make it hard for Duke's guards to shoot over. So I think they were just trying to stall Duke a little bit, just take some time off the clock by putting a light press on them, letting them come over half court, and then just having their big players just contest everything. And, you know, honestly, the whole game was just a very impressive showing of impressive fucking elite shot making by Duke's guards, man. Mm-hmm. Like, Duke's guards made some fucking very elite shots, man, from Jared McCain to Jeremy Roach. You know, I was really impressed at what they did. So, you know, I never felt like Duke was going to lose the game, but I did feel like, you know, towards the end, you know, it was going to get a little tough on them. And that's how I felt about it.
Yeah, I think you made the right point there, AC. When he brought up the guards making big plays, I thought Taylor Foster made a couple of really big plays late, and I thought that obviously every time he needed a dagger, and this was the one that, to me, put the game away, and it was, you know, still probably, I can't remember what the timestamp was. You guys can go back and look at it, but Jeremy Roach's 3 to put us back up in double digits, that to me was dagger 3. And it's like every time we need something like that, he did it against Wake. He's done it countless times this year. He's done it throughout his career. Every time we need something like that, he just lets the game come to him. He's like, all right, McCain's cooking tonight. You go for it, bro. You got this. Mm-hmm. When it's time for me, I'll step up. And I feel like that's what he did yet again.
Yeah, Jerm's the closer. Like, that's old news. That's old news.
You don't need film for it.
No, we can move on. I thought that I do want to give a shout out before we move on, actually, to Sean Stewart. I know he didn't play more than 4 and change, but he made multiple phenomenal, just game changing plays to get buckets for his team, to make decisive plays. I think he ended up with 4 rebounds. Like, the guy, look, when he
gets a couple steals too, right?
Yeah, I mean, there we go. Like, he comes up and makes plays. I mean, I'll let D go ahead. Like, I think Sean Stewart, when his number is called, he's like, hey, whether it's 2 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever, I'll come in and contribute.
I've used the word effort before, but I think I'm going to start using the word motor, not effort, because effort is like a bad, it just gives like a negative vibe, right? So let's use the word motor. Like, I think Duke at times lacks a motor, and this is across the board for each player, except Sean Stewart. I don't think at any given time this kid is not, oh, and friend of the podcast, Jalen Blake. So let's throw him in. And I don't know. That's it.
And Jared McCain. Like, I will never.
No.
Come on, man. That guy's never.
Stewart is revving at 100,000 RPMs.
I think I see what you're saying. It's different. That's why using the word effort is obviously not.
I don't like that.
Not what you're trying to use here because Jared's measured. He's very measured.
You can be measured and still have the motor, though.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think his motor is great because of what he always does. If he's off the ball, you talk about all the time. He's off the ball. He's in shooting stance. He's in the proper position. He's in the passing position to receive the pass. He's always in the right angle.
Actually, the other word I would use is engaged. He's mm-hmm. always engaged.
He's very high IQ also. But if we're talking about dudes who you just like super unhinged, let them out of the cage, and they're just going to fucking run for hours.
Sean Stewart's the Four Loko.
Yeah,
I'm a Four Loko. Come podcast. 100%. Sean Stewart's the Four Loko. You never know what you're going to get in that can, bro. But 100%. Whatever it is potent,
full,
not
full of amphetamines. Like, he's just
it's
ready
gonna
to go.
It's going to hurt you or it's going to hurt the other team.
and I'll take.
Jeez, AC.
He's got some shit that you cannot game plan for, that you can't coach against, that you can't even coach. The fact that he can jump 4 fucking feet off the ground. It's uncoachable, undefendable.
It's kind of like what Mason Plumlee was when he was a freshman. Like, his athleticism was game changing at times, but you never knew what you're going to get out of that dude when he was a freshman.
100%. But still, you never knew some of those mistakes, right?
You might get a left-handed free throw out of Mason Plumlee. You have no idea what you're going to get out of that dude.
It kind of been worse.
Y'all were talking about Duke social media going crazy. Like, if Jared McCain didn't have X, Y, and Z, we would have lost. I think John was fully prepared to just let Stewart run for 15 minutes if he had to.
Mm-hmm.
But you got McCain cooking, so there's really no need to throw that big. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So there's really no need to play big versus big to try to match up with. So, like,
Ball handling was premium that game against FSU.
I thought he played more than 4 minutes, but maybe it was less.
His impact felt bigger than 4 minutes. So, like,
it did, and it did, and that says something, right? That's why I really believe that John was ready to let him run for 12, 15 minutes, if that's what it took, to go big for big.
I think that what ended up happening here is that, Sean might look at that and be like, oh, I only played 4 minutes and change, but the coaching staff is being like, those were massive minutes that you played for this team, and
invaluable.
And you made winning plays.
Throw the ball twice, saved the ball out of bounds a few times. Like, I mean,
the steal.
He was a disruptor.
Picking up all the way to the half court line, making that steal, allowing Flip to get the easy bucket, and those are winning plays. And that's how you not only win games, but like you kind of make your mark as a player. And I think that Sean Stewart did a really good job of that. Jalen Blake, we talked about him. He made some big plays, and Ryan Nunn did as well. Anybody else want to add anything in about the Florida State game? Because we got some mailbag that we got to get to.
Shout out Jay Roach for putting up 17. Nobody noticed because nobody ever notices when he does that, but especially not that game. I don't know. I mean, Jeremy and Flip. Most of them were in the second half, I think. No, most of them were in the first half, it looks like.
Really? Yeah, they didn't score a whole lot in the second.
McCain had a couple free throws and 1-3. I know that.
Mm-hmm. I feel like Duke didn't score a whole lot in the second half, I'm just going to be honest.
They scored 32 in the second half after putting up 44 in the first. They got outscored 33-32 in the second half.
Yeah.
But overall, like, again, every time the Florida State was – making a little bit of a mini run. It's not like Florida State shot the ball great or anything like that. I thought our defense was really good. And again, Duke out-rebounded a bigger team. So, like, you know, while Flip had the 6 turnovers and didn't have his best game, I thought Duke did enough winning things to you know, obviously not only close out that game, but to never kind of let that game be in doubt. And that's really what was important. So, yeah, I want to get to the mailbag. We got some good questions.
Yeah, let's go.
And the first one, I want to get to Pablo here, because I feel like you're the best person to answer this. But how, if at all, has the scouting report changed since Jared McCain's 35-point performance? What does it open up offensively? Who benefits the most? And that comes from your boy, DH, the composer.
So the scouting McCain, scouting report on Jared McCain. Obviously, I mean, he's going to get bumped up in the scouting report against everybody we play against. So, you know, instead of him being a, you know, maybe the third or fourth guy on the scouting list, probably going to get bumped up to like number two. You know what I mean? They're going to try to, you know, take him out the game, obviously, you know, run him off the 3-point line, try to limit some of his touches, limit some of the playmaking things that he do, obviously limit him from getting to the basket. You'll probably see more players just playing them a lot closer, you know, trying to get into him, pause, you know what I'm saying, and just trying to, you know, make him put the ball on the floor, but just trying to, you know, force him away from the basket, maybe push him towards sideline or even to the baseline.
Was a deep question.
Yeah, the second part of that question is, what does that open up for everybody else? Like, how does the scouting report change now that you do have to focus, to your point, focus on Jared McCain? Now he's probably the second, you know, option in terms of your scouting report defensively. Everybody knows that Flip's still the first. But how does that now open things up for everybody else? And what does that do to defensive game plans now that you do have to focus on him?
Yeah, so, I mean, you know, anytime you have a guy that just emerges as a scorer or just any kind of offensive threat, you know what I mean? It just, you know, other players obviously can benefit off of it as long as, you know, that they're aggressive in spots that they could be aggressive in. Obviously, you know, they want to take away Jared McCain. So, you know, the defense is kind of keying on him. They're focusing on him. They're already focusing on Flip. We know that, you know what I'm saying? So, it let guys like, you know, guys get a lot more open shots. I'll tell you that, you know what I'm saying? Like, it'll give guys like Caleb Foster a lot more time to, you know what I'm saying? Like play off the ball some more, do a lot of catching, shooting, you know, some slashing, some different things. It could really benefit guys like Sean Stewart. It could really benefit a guy like that can, you know, play on the weak side, hit the offensive rebounds. You know what I mean? Like if shots are missed, obviously take some pressure off Flip, you know what I'm saying? If you combine those guys, put those guys in a pick and roll, now you really got a dilemma on your hands, you know what I'm saying? As far as like what you want to take away, you know what I mean? How do you want to guard that pick and roll with like a Jared McCain in the Flip, you know? So, I mean, it's a multitude of things that you could do. And as far as John Shire goes, you know, on offense, shit, there's so much more he can do, man. When you have a guy like Jared McCain, bro, like it's so much more you can do. I could sit here and probably talk for 45 minutes about the different things on offense that you could do. That's gonna benefit Duke.
Yeah, AC. I think one of the things. Go ahead, D. Go ahead.
No, my bad, TK. I was just gonna say before I forget. I mean, that's one of the things that Duke could utilize as like luxury with Tyrese Proctor throwing over the top of that defense to the corner, to the elbow in a pick and roll situation when Flip is not, Flip doesn't have to do all the heavy lifting. It could open up lanes for Proctor to get to the basket because this Duke team needs Proctor to be able to get to the rim with that elite layup package that he has and score. It'll open up the dunker slot for either Flip Stewart or Mark. Like McCain, I don't know if McCain's number two on the scouting report. He might be number one. You need to force him off that 3-point line because if you let him just sit out there, now the floor is stretched, now the floor is spaced, and you don't have and Flip can work freely. Mark can flow baseline to baseline. Tyrese Proctor and the other guards can just drive to the basket. I mean, he might be number one on the scouting report.
It definitely
I don't know if he elevates. I don't know if he elevates number one unless he I don't know if he elevates to number one on that scouting report unless he's hit. Like, I don't think he starts the game as number one on the scouting report. I think the game starts with Flip as number one. If Tyrese Proctor is in and healthy, he's still number two, and I think McCain's right there. But what that does do, to kind of continue to answer that question more, it opens up things for Proctor and Flip. It makes life easier for them because now the pressure's off of them a little bit. Two guys that are kind of struggling mentally, the pressure is now taken off of them because they have a third guy who's helping them out. And you kind of saw Jared giving Flip the look-away treatment like he was getting from Flip early in the season. Yeah. Flip was calling for the ball in the post, and Jared's like, "I'm shooting. Don't worry about it."
I got it. Three.
So, you know what I mean? I think it can make life easier for them. And then if those two can begin or continue to work together well as well, like, I don't think you're going to see Jared running the short roll with Pick or anything, or Flip or anything, but I think those two can work off of each other. Because you're doubling is, unless Ryan Young's in the game or unless Jalen Blake's in the game, doubling is not so much of an option anymore for teams. So Flip is going to be able to get back to getting some one-on-one coverage. Like, our guards are going to continue to be able to slash. Like, and now you're taking a better defender from somebody like Caleb Foster or Jeremy Roach or Tyrese Proctor and putting them on Jared McCain, and that's trouble, man. Like, I think you, as the other team, I think you almost live with, at least at the beginning of the game, let Jared shoot. It's not a high percentage shot. So, I mean, it's a 43% shot, but it's not a high percentage shot. It's still a lower percentage shot than a layup or anything else. So you kind of take your risk. Do you take the 3 points or do you try to let him miss? Like, who knows?
I wouldn't do that, but I do agree with D. Like, that the thing that I brought to you, and AC, you said as well, that I thought that what would end up happening here, and I think that he will be the second priority, at least for the time being. Until someone else proves otherwise, he will be the second, you know, option in terms of defensive scouting for other teams. Mm-hmm. That it's going to open things up for our other guards. It's going to open up for Tyrese Proctor. He's the first person that came to my mind. Jeremy Roach is who he is. Like, we know he can do whatever against any game plan. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. The third thing is that Caleb Foster is probably going to get some more opening lanes. But the other thing D mentioned, if the lane's going to be open, that's going to leave things open for Mark Mitchell, for Sean. It may even leave some things open for Flip. Jack, kind of where do you stand on this? Like, you know, to me, I think that Pablo is right. I think he's the two option now, not only for scouting, but for Duke.
Yeah, I mean,
fair point.
I don't want to say he's the second option yet, just because, you know, he's had a few explosive games, which is always great, but, you know, Flip and Jeremy are still 1A and 1B, really, long-term for this team, I think. And this is – it's hard for me to say that either of them could be relegated lower than Jared, not because of Jared's play, but because we know what those guys can be down the stretch, and we've seen it. Like, those guys are still in my book. I mean, again, Jeremy's going to do what he's going to do. That's just going to happen. So he might be – he might be two on the scouting report, but he is not. He's not Duke's second option yet. I think if he has a few more of those, like 20 pieces, we can have that conversation. But I'm not ready to say that he's going to be an option above either Flip or Jeremy.
But hold on, Jack. What you said right there, Jeremy's going to get his points regardless of the scouting report, right?
Yes, so, I'm saying on the scout, I agree, but. For Duke,
scouting report be damned, why wouldn't you want to stop somebody else? All right, if Jeremy, let's let Jeremy get Jeremy's points, because he's going to get him, whether we double, triple, whether we sag, all whatever we do, Jeremy's going to get his points, right?
Yes.
All right, so we're going to lock in on McCain. McCain, you ain't shooting a damn ball all game.
Yeah, I
this is kind of.
I think we're saying the same thing. I think we're saying the same thing, D.
You're probably right, but I mean, it's kind of how I feel about Duke. How they guard Carolina next game. Ingram, we're going to be in your pocket, bro. You're not touching the
ball. Here's the difference. The difference here is that McCain's not – he's not a primary ball handler, and I think that's the difference. I think
– yeah.
He is a scorer straight up. Like, that's his job is to score. He's not facilitating. He doesn't facilitate. That's not his job. Sure. And when he does facilitate, he has 5 turnovers like he did this past game. Like, 35 points also.
We're not talking about those yet, are we?
Right. So, you know, the points cover that up, but still, he's not a facilitator. That's not his job. That's not his role. We have three other guards who can do that. We got Caleb Foster, Jeremy Roach, and Tyrese Proctor who can facilitate. We don't need Jared McCain to facilitate.
Agreed.
So I think that's the difference. I think, like, Jeremy, sometimes he's difficult to guard because sometimes his role is facilitating, and then all of a sudden he's going to put up, like, 8 straight points on you. Like, that's difficult. Like, we need Caleb and we need Tyrese to kind of pick it up a little bit more on and for the guard scoring for our backcourt to be as brutal as it can be for other teams. We need them just to be a little bit more consistent, a little bit more aggressive.
If McCain can develop some sort of pump fake, strong dribble drive to the rim, layup pass, watch out.
I think he already has that.
Yeah, he definitely has it too.
I know he has it, but he doesn't.
He doesn't use it as much as he should.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, when you're cooking from outside, you don't need to showcase it as much. But I feel like a lot of games, and even recently, when he hasn't been shooting as well from the outside, he's done a really good job of getting in. I think it was also the Clemson game where he went in there and he wasn't cooking from the outside and got in there into the lane. He finds a way to get himself to the line as well. And I'll say this.
As if I'm the opposing coach and we're talking scouting, I'm running him off of all the screens, all the three-point line. I don't want him to touch the ball.
I don't disagree with you there. Pablo, where do you kind of stand on all this? Because, I mean, there are a lot of good points have been made. But I kind of want to feel, you know, understand where you feel on this entire thing.
I mean, I think everybody bring up some good points. At the end of the day, man, I don't know. I feel as if Duke and what we do, we can just, I don't know, man. Let me think about that. Give me a minute.
We'll give me a second. I do want to bring this back. And D, I'll let you have this one because I understand, I think, exactly what you were saying when Jack brought up the Jeremy Roach point, where Jeremy Roach is going to get his, and maybe he's on the scouting report as, you know, kind of the second option. But I kind of look at it differently, where, you know,
nobody puts their best defender on Jeremy Roach. Nobody does.
Exactly. And I kind of look at it as, like, Jeremy's going to – he just does such a great job of letting the game come to him. That, like, he's not going to be that guy that, like, you're going to be scouting against necessarily. But Jared McCain, you have to scout. You have got to, because he could go off for 35. I don't, yeah. As much as I love Jeremy Roach, I don't see him going off for 35.
This is going to sound crazy, but just stick with the point for a second. Roach could easily go off for 35. He's that good. He's that crafty of a basketball player. He's a veteran. He could easily go off for 35 if you give him the space to do it. McCain is simply more talented than Roach in shooting the ball and maybe even defensively and rebounding. I don't know. I don't want to start a war up here.
I think because of Jerm's role as a facilitator, you like him going off at 35. I think honestly is not good for our guards and the rest of our team.
Yeah, I agree. If he's putting up 35, something's very wrong.
The question was,
you think who going off for 35 isn't good?
No, not Jeremy Roach.
I think him going for 35 would disrupt the rhythm of the backcourt. I guess that's about. It's not that it's not good. I think it would disrupt the rhythm of the backcourt.
But AC, let me
say this real quick.
If you need 35 from Roach, he'll give you 35.
He'll get it for you.
Yes, he will.
He'll give you 35.
I think what we're saying,
McCain is flat out more talented. That's who's on the top of the scouting point for me. I'm gonna let Roach do him.
I think what we're all saying, and we probably all can agree to, that Jared McCain's 35 is probably more impactful.
Yeah.
For the what I'm saying, for the whole game.
Yes.
And then like a 35 from Jeremy Roach. I think that we can probably all agree to that. I think
when your scorer is getting 35, when your scorer is scoring, that sucks for the other team. Bottom line, like when your scorer scores, it sucks. Doesn't matter who else scores. When your scorer scores, it sucks. It's like the Danny Ferry comparison that Jack brought up earlier. When your scorer is scoring, it sucks for the other team.
And it's not
if you guys haven't seen that game, though, it's a really fun watch.
So I'm going to make somebody else beat me if I'm an opposing coach. Jared McCain won't.
You got to.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's exactly right. You know, if you're the opposing coach, you let Jeremy Roach get 35 because he's not going to be what's best for Duke. And I think that's the point you're making. I 100% agree with that. Okay, let's get to a second question here. Another question came from on the Discord from our boy the Better the Better. Biggest takeaways from the selection committee's early reveal and the thoughts on the ACC total bids this year. He thinks that we get 5. AC, I know that you, me, and Jack have definitely debated this one on this podcast. So, AC, I'll give you the first word here on, you know, ACC overall and kind of like the early reveal, if you saw it.
I actually hadn't seen the early reveal.
Duke was, I want to say, the last 3 seed.
Yes. Right. Yeah, we've been the last 3 seed all Carolina season.
Carolina was the first 2 seed out of 5. So,
which is not going to stay.
No, it's not going to, but, you know, kind of your first reactions to it and the fact that the ACC got a little bit more love from the committee than it does from your bracketologists and the AP voters as a whole.
We got to win games, man. That's the bottom line. Let's keep winning games. Like, let's keep beating teams that are in front of us because they offer different shit that we're going to see in the tournament. That's my only takeaway from this thing, man. We haven't moved off that. We've been the 3 or 4 seed as a top 10 team this entire season, and that shit is so fraudulent. That's so dumb, man. Like, obviously the AP poll doesn't matter, clearly, but like, what kind of message are you sending as the media and everything else if you have a top 10 team and you're gonna lower them down to the 3 or 4 line and then say that even if they win the ACC and win an ACC tournament, they're not coming off the 3 line? Because I saw that. Like, what? Are you serious with that conversation? Like, okay, whatever. Then we'll be the 3 seed and we'll ruin somebody's bracket. That's fine.
Yeah,
that's cool. We'll ruin somebody's bracket as a 3 seed. I don't give a fuck. Like,
I was literally good. That was my answer. I was gonna be like, AC, watch out real quick. I want everybody to see the banner behind you.
Let's win games. Let's keep winning games and let's keep taking care of our business. That's my feeling on it. The ACC, I think, will get 4 teams in. I don't think we get 5. Clemson, I think Wake sneaks in. I think it's UNC and it's us. So, I'm sorry, because UVA is there too. Clemson or Wake will get knocked out because that section of the AC standings is going to eat itself up. Like, you saw tonight, UVA just lost to Virginia Tech by 30 almost. So, yeah, that whole middle section is just going to eat itself up, and you're not going to get enough quality wins, quote unquote, even though the ACC killed the non-conference this year. Like, that can't be a complaint this year as it was last season. So, whatever. I don't know. They want the Big Ten in the tournament. So, congratulations. You have basketball in the tournament. Great. Good job for you.
I think you'll see Wake play for their life every game for the rest of the season.
They should. They need to.
I think they're a tournament team right now. That's me.
They have no chance.
Go ahead, Jack, because I agree with you. I think Wake's a good team.
I think Wake's a tournament team. I think Virginia's going to get in because they're Virginia and not because they deserve to. I think, obviously, Duke and UNC are going to be in the tournament. I think Pitt is making a really good case right now. They've won 7 of 8. They're tied for 4th in the ACC with Wake and State. I think Clemson has a shot, like a really, really long shot. They're on the wrong side of the bubble, but
Clemson's a good tournament team.
They are. I think last year they got screwed, and I think this is a better team they have this year. I think State's got a shot. Again, they're on the wrong side of the bubble, but I think the ACC has a good case at 5, maybe even 6.
Like, all those teams you're talking about should be in ahead of certain Big East teams and certain Big Ten teams that are going to be in the tournament, but
they're going to have to show up.
You already know how it's going to go. For real. It doesn't matter.
State, take care of our Clemson, business. And Pitt are going to have to win some games in the ACC tournament. So they might end up knocking themselves, like you said earlier, cannibalizing each other because they're going to end up knocking themselves out because each one of those teams needs to make a strong run in this ACC tournament in front of the committee the day before selection show. You know what I mean? Which is sad because they shouldn't have to.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's fair. Pablo, how about this one? Kind of flipping a little bit to Duke, what do you see as Duke's best-case scenario versus their worst-case scenario? Because, you know, and be honest with the schedule, right? So we have 6 games left, and honestly, nobody feels like we're going to lose all 6 games, right? And we're not going to lose in the ACC tournament. you know, first round and then whatever. But like, so kind of like looking at a realistic best case, worst case scenario for Duke, where do you kind of see the opportunities for us just seeding wise? And then I want to get into matchup wise, because I think that's the more important question. But let's talk seeding wise in your opinion.
You're talking about for as far as like as many games we got left, or are you talking about like once we're in the tournament?
I want to know what your opinion is like, how high can we go in terms of seeding?
So
like, what is realistic? Now, obviously, we win them all and we win the tournament and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, sure. We'll probably get a ticket.
So if we do all that, and if we take care of business and we win it all and win the tournament and all that shit, then obviously three seed, you know what I'm saying? Maybe two. I think that'd be tough to justify that, but I guess it just depends on, you know, how North Carolina finishes or whatever. I think we might be able to even replace them.
So if Duke wins six games in a row and the ACC tournament, you don't think they get a two seed at least?
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
Duke's already on a four-game streak, so that's 10 plus three in the ACC tournament.
My question to Pablo was realistically.
Okay, fair enough.
Realistically, I think we're going to probably end up being a three. I think that's probably realistic, because I'm not sure if we win all of our games out, the rest of our games out. And then
as
come
long
ACC
as we don't
tournament
lose
time.
To like Miami, that's the biggest thing, because Miami is no longer like, what, they're like quad two now, maybe quad three, because of all the games they've lost.
I think
it's two because we're on the road.
A Wake Forest loss would be a quad two, correct?
They're quad one.
Even after losing to.
Yeah, they're quad one still. They're like
let me check the rankings.
I think the toughest shit gonna be for us with all the games we got left is just obviously North Carolina again and Virginia. I think that's gonna be our toughest ones. You know what I mean? For sure.
We have to play at NC State.
Right. I actually think.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. But I feel like this team, I feel like we're gonna steamroll them.
Okay.
I really feel like that.
I really hope that you're right. I don't want to hear the bullshit.
I don't know
if it's not true.
That's what I'm saying. I don't like. I know what's happening.
That's
in the
scariest arena in the world to me. I'm sorry.
Fuck all that shit. That's the same thing people were saying when we played Virginia Tech. Fuck them.
That's fair. You that's fair. That's fair. Talk to them.
Wake is Q1 because it's on the road.
Okay.
Where's Miami? I cannot find Miami on here. Miami is on the road.
We should not lose to Miami.
No,
Miami is Q2 on the road. They're 79.
Miami is fucking cheeks this year, bro.
Yeah,
they are.
They lost way too much.
We have to get past Wake and State. Those are the two big red flags. Yeah. Obviously, UNC March 9th.
Yeah, we'll get to that one, Jack. But obviously, we also have to get past at home. Jack's Louisville Cardinals, so we're just gonna
connect me to them, TK.
Time out. UVA is in that six games somewhere.
No, we're gonna smoke UVA.
That's a gauntlet.
I think this is gonna be a good test for the rest of the way. I think the six games
are gonna
be a great test for the
toughest game.
Fair point.
Yeah. UVA is Pablo.
I think that's gonna be our toughest game.
What
UVA?
Is it?
Virginia.
Yeah.
Matchup. I think they match up really well with Duke. You know what I'm saying? I think that the matchup and just the way that they play defense, you know what I mean, for what we try to do and we want to get to the paint and do the different things that we want to do, and, you know, they like to run guys off the line. I think they're built for, you know, to play against Duke, you know what I mean, to be honest with you. So I think it's going to be tough. I think it's going to be tough for us. I really believe that.
I think Duke is – This is going to sound awful, but I don't know if they have the intestinal fortitude not to let UVA dictate how this game is played, and the game and the speed at which this game is played.
Virginia.
I think this team can
the way they play. They're gonna. I mean, it doesn't matter who they play. They normally. Virginia's dictating the pace because of how they fucking play. You know
and
what
that's
saying?
How they on win. Defense. But if you don't allow them to dictate the pace and you say, damn that, I'm going to do me, you'll beat Virginia.
You got to think about it, though, D. What can you do? Beat them up. You know what I'm saying? Like, you
beat them up.
They shoot the ball and then they just all run back on defense. You know what I'm saying? They're not really trying to crash. They're not trying to do none of that shit. What they're trying to do is set up their half-court defense so nobody, almost nobody ever runs on Virginia.
You're going to have to flow off that elbow and just get downhill.
Yeah, no. I mean,
your offense has to be efficient against UVA, but either way, we got a bunch of tests moving down the stretch. We got teams that are fighting for their tournament lives. We got a rubber match against UNC. We got a UVA team that obviously, you know, always plays tough, and you know, you gotta deal with that pack line shit and deal with a bad shooting night. So that's all stuff you're gonna see in the tournament. Like, so I think this is a good test. Whether we come out of this 4-2, 6-0, 0-6, whatever, 0-12, if we come out of the 6-game stretch, 0-12, whatever, you know, whatever it is, as long as we learn something going into the tournament, that's all I care about, man.
Yeah,
like whatever. Seed be damned. They're never going to give us the benefit of the doubt for any of these fucking seeds. Every team ahead of us can lose 6 games the rest of the season, and we will still be a 3 seed. It doesn't fucking matter. So let us be a 3 seed and fuck somebody's day up. That's how I feel about it.
If Duke runs the table, I think a 2 seed's very, very plausible. But
we should be a 1 seed.
Duke's more than likely.
There's no other resume in the country that matches us winning out. But if we went out, they're not going to give us, I promise you, they're not going to give us that respect. Won't. Because they have,
that's why
they have
to choose more plausible.
The agenda.
I'm with Jack on this one. That I think if we went out, Jack, that we get the 2. No doubt.
I think we replace Carolina.
I will say this. And Jack, I'll give you this one before we move on to previews. Is that I think there's too many teams ahead of us to get a 1. But I do believe if we went out, we get the top 2.
Yeah. I think Duke will be a 2 if they run the table. If they win the ACC, if they beat Carolina, if they beat Virginia, I think Wake, Virginia, Carolina, and the ACC tournament. If they show up to those, it's a 2.
Easy.
I mean, we have 2 losses since December 9th. There's not many other teams. Outside of Connecticut, there's not many teams that can boast that type of resume. The problem is how the rest of the ACC is being viewed unfairly, in my opinion. So, I think if we run the table, we should get a 1 seed. That's 1 seed material. If we win these, we're beating 4 quad 1. Just 4 quad 1 wins. Like, what else do you want? Like, and then you win a conference championship, but that's not enough. Like, that's how it's going to play out, though. So it's fine.
Well, it wasn't enough for a 4 seed last year.
Right, I know, exactly. Right. So we'll be a 3 seed. We'll be a 3 seed, and we will ruin somebody's bracket. Which is awesome. I love that.
Love it. All right. So let's get to a couple previews. Obviously, Wednesday night, we got at Miami. So let's start with that one before we get to the rubber match with Wake Forest. And, you know, AC kind of talked about Miami. We talked about the fact that this was a team, you know, that I kind of predicted before the season that was going to be really good this year. They just kind of fell off a cliff. So kind of talk about them and talk about how Duke matches up with them now. And honestly, they're, you know, you said it earlier, everybody's playing for their lives right now. Maybe Miami doesn't have a life, you know, in terms of, you know, making the tournament unless they win the ACC tournament. But kind of talk about their team and how we match up.
No, I mean, Larinaga's already in press conferences talking about possibly shutting down Nigel Pack with his, because he has a lower body injury that he got a couple games ago. I think it was BC or something. Like Jim Larinaga looks at the season. I think he looks at the season as a lost season. I think it's done for them.
Defeated.
Like, yeah, whatever you can do to help your players earn some NBA stock or something, or maybe just pull for the next season. Cause I know a lot of them will be back for next year. You know, you do what you can, but I mean, this isn't going to be this is not a typical trap game where it's like, okay, we go to Miami, you know, we could lose. Like, we don't have anything really to look forward to after that other than Wake. So it's like, let's focus on this game and go down and take care of business. Like, they are an extremely beatable team who is hurting, who is reeling. They have injuries all over the place. They got guys playing with injuries. They got guys who are injured not playing. Like, let's just go take care of business with this team, man. Like, we know who they are. We know they got Wuga Poplar. We know they got Norchad Omier. They got, you know, Nigel Pack's not playing. Matt Cleveland, I love him as a player. He just hasn't taken the Jim Larinaga system. Like, but they're going to play hard. Like, they're going to play tough. They're a tough playing team. We got to bury them. Like, they've been fairly close in a lot of games they've lost, but they've lost like 5 games in a row. Like, it would be inexcusable we go to Miami and lose, quite honestly. I know it's an ACC game on the road or whatever, but if we're talking about seeding and if we're trying to prove some points here, let's go take care of business in Miami.
Yeah, score prediction. 75-41.
Nah, not that bad.
That's what your Hokies just beat.
That's what Tech just did the UVA. But what's up?
Yes,
that's final.
Yeah, they beat the shit out of them. But either way, like it's. I think it'll be a little bit low scoring. They try to slow you down a little bit too because they can't run. It's not a difficult gym to shoot in. I could see another decent Jerry McCain game, but not another 35er. But fuck it, man. Like 75 to 69. Like I think it'll be fairly close. They keep games close.
75-69. Nice. Jack, go ahead.
Omier is good. I am very intrigued to see how Flip plays him. You know, he got hurt in the last game that Duke played against Miami, which honestly kind of sucked to see. You know, it was a really good Miami team, obviously, last year. This is not that. Hopefully he doesn't, like, triple his three-point made total for the season like he did last year the first time we played Miami. Matt Cleveland, like AC said, good hooper, really not acclimating to Laranjego well, which is a shame. But yeah, Wuga Poplar, whose name is incredibly fun to say, he's going to put up his points. You know, they've got a team of good players that just don't seem to be a good team.
Yeah.
It's gonna be a single digit margin of victory for Duke, but it's gonna be, I'm gonna say 81-74.
Oh, so you're about to give them predictions.
I gave a prediction last game, sir.
All right, love it. D, what do you got?
Single digits is embarrassing for this Miami team. I'm sorry. They're just not the Miami that we are used to. Anything less than 15 plus points is a disappointment, in my opinion. I don't really care about the score so much as I care about seeing people get back on track. Dadgum, excuse me, guys. I want to see some people get back on track. Mitchell, who had four great games, hasn't had a few good games. Let's see him get back on track. Let's cut down the turnovers. Let's rebound the ball well. And let's just get back to playing some fundamentally sound Duke offensive basketball, and the shots will, like Novocaine, it will work. So anything over 80, I'm good with Duke.
Yeah, that's your magic number. Pablo, I know you just want to fucking win.
That's the bottom line, man. You know what I'm saying? Fuck the predictions. To go out there and win the goddamn basketball game. And let's shut these goddamn fans up. It's like, stop talking shit.
Yeah. I don't know if they will, but
it won't.
Yeah. It just felt
good saying that, though.
It did. I bet it did.
That's fair. I'll give my normal prediction. I like, unfortunately, single digits from this one. I like 72-65. It's just kind of the feeling that I get for this one, but we find a way to win. AC, we got the rematch with Wake. I think that, to me, is the big game. I thought coming into the three-game road stretch that, if you know, unfortunately, you would take 2-1. You obviously mm-hmm. want to win all three. But mm-hmm. if we were going to lose a game, this, to me, was going to be the one we would lose. How do you see this game shaping up? Because I don't think Reed's going to have four fouls, you know, again, you know, early and then foul out. I think it's going to be a much different ball game. I don't think they're going to shoot as poorly. Because they're playing at home, but, you know, you tell me, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, the thing that happened to them last time, they just couldn't hit threes, right? Like, Monsanto couldn't get on. I think he was, like, 2-for-9 or something. Like, we held them down from the three-point line. They still shot almost 50% from the floor, but they shot, like, 26% from three. So, it's going to be depending on what Forbes' game plan is going to be, man. Is he going to try to get inside? Like, our defense is going to have to show up for that game. I think you're right. I don't think Reed fouls out as quickly as he did. Playing at their home, especially. And he was having a good game when he was in. Like, he was giving Flip some trouble. So I think defensively we got to figure something out to kind of slow them down a little bit. Salas had a decent game. He wasn't inefficient. He had a really good, efficient game, in my opinion. So that's kind of their engine, is Hunter Salas. But, you know, if Carr was – he was getting some buckets. Like, they were getting buckets against us and keeping the game fairly close at Cameron. So – and they're playing for a tournament, man. Like, this is a quad one, like, get right win for them that gets them in the tournament, I think. So it's gonna be tough. I think it's gonna be tough. I'm not gonna sit here and predict a loss. I'm gonna tell you how I think we can win the game, which is I think attacking the bucket, getting them in foul trouble, especially the bigs, because they don't have a deep bench. And I don't think we can settle for threes in Wake Forest. You know, we don't shoot there well there generally anywhere. It's a difficult shooting gym. A lot of the ACC gyms are. So we got to get to the bucket and get those guys in foul trouble. Let's say we do that. I think the score is probably going to be about 82-75 because we can score against them. Like, defensively, they're not scary.
All right, Jack, what do you got?
I just hope the game is officiated well, because the last one was a travesty.
Both ways.
Wake got screwed and Duke got screwed. It was probably the worst officiated game I've ever seen. And it was horrendous. I just want to see a well-officiated game. You know, I want to see the rules properly applied. I want to see basketballs that deflect off of players properly called for possession. Boy, all that aside, I want Duke to win, of course. I think Duke can put up a solid 85-78, pretty reasonable. You know, Monsanto's probably going to have a better game. Reed's probably not going to get 3 fouls in 2 minutes. But I think attacking the interior with Mitchell, with McCain, with Proctor if he's healthy, with Roach, and, of course, Filipowski is going to be key. You use the guys you have who are good at scoring inside. Get to the ball, or get to the bucket, get to the line, get their lack of depth exposed.
D, what do you got?
I don't know. Their bench scored 16-plus points last game. Just fucking win, man. Just go out there and impose your will on these dudes. You play like you know that you're the best player on the court, and it'll take care of itself. Like, you know, just fucking win. Just fucking win.
Pablo, do you have anything to add to that? Because, I mean, he just stole your line.
Nah, that's what I was just saying. Just preach. He was taking him to church on that shit. So, hey, I'm with you on that. You know what I'm saying? I feel the same way. Just fucking win, bro. Like, I don't care how they do it. I don't care if we win by goddamn half a point. You know what I'm saying? Just fucking win.
Vegas is the only people that would care about half a point.
Yeah, yeah.
And facts. I don't give a fuck about Vegas.
Just I don't either. Hey, Valentine might, but I know I don't.
I guarantee just you win. We get him. I feel like we have a good opportunity to really make a statement by closing this three-game road stretch out with three wins. And I think that we find a way to do that. And I think it's going to be an epic fashion. I think that we're going to be down maybe 10 at halftime. And we're going to come back and find a way to win this game. And I think we're going to get a Jeremy Roach bucket with like 3 seconds left. And we're going to win this game 81-80. I think that's what we're going to do. Yeah.
So we're going to get the Louisville game part two.
A fucking panic attack already.
No, I mean, if you're honest about it, this is going to be a tough game. It's much like
a good Wake Forest basketball team.
It's a really good team. It's much like AC said that like they're playing for their life right now.
Yep.
And they're playing at home, and they feel like they didn't play their best when they played at Duke. But you know, the other thing is that Duke made a lot of really dumb turnovers in that game. Especially in the first half.
I don't think Duke played their best either.
No, I don't think we played our best either, but we found ways to win at home. And Wake Forest is saying the same thing to themselves right now, is that they were at home, now we got them at our place. But we're going to find enough ways to make some plays in the second half, and we're going to win that game. And normally, we end this podcast with our previews and our predictions, but we got one more thing here. Duke social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, not on our Patreon and not on our Discord, but message boards, everything else, like the negativity, that just the garbage, that the attacking our players, it has to stop. And Pablo, you already said right now that, you know, D was preaching about the weight game. I want you to take these fuckers to church and talk to them. Talk to them. Talk to Duke Nation right now and tell them how it's going to be.
Listen, man, this is all the Duke fans, right? It's not. I'm not even talking to the good ones right now. The good fans, they already know what time it is. It's for all you fuckers that be talking crazy DMing players, tagging players, doing all that bullshit, man. Ain't nobody trying to hear that. Nope. Go cheer for somebody else, man. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, let these guys figure out what they need to figure out. You saw David Bradley come up on it. You know what I'm saying? He posted it. I thought the tweet was really well said. You know what I'm saying? He tweeted it out. You know what I'm saying? For everybody to see. I think everything he said was facts. You know what I'm saying? These players see this shit. You know what I'm saying? They absolutely see this shit. So if y'all want to keep, you know, writing negative shit and, you know what I'm saying, which could affect future recruits and things like that, you know what I'm saying? Keep doing what you do. You know what I'm saying? And then you're going to, you know what I'm saying? You're going to see the team fall off the ledge. You know what I mean? Hopefully that doesn't happen. And hopefully our guys stay strong and they stay connected. But y'all motherfuckers, man, y'all got to chill the fuck out. You know what I'm saying? Y'all bugging. Y'all really bugging. You know what I'm saying? Just tweeting this bullshit. Leave these good dudes alone, man. These are kids, man. First and foremost, because I know, period. You know what I'm saying? I don't give a fuck. If somebody talk about my kid, I'm ready to beat your ass. That's what I'm ready to do. You know what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, I know these parents are probably feeling the same thing, because I know these kids are going back telling their parents, and their parents are seeing this shit. Sure. You know, and their girlfriends are seeing this shit. Their siblings are seeing this shit. What are we doing? You know what I'm saying? What are we doing out here, bro? Like, and these are fucking adults.
I really hope that they, for all the negative people out there, that these players see some of the positive shit out there too. You know, like, yeah. I really hope that these guys hear us say this so-and-so deserves flowers and such deserves flowers. Like, I really hope that, because you're absolutely right.
Nah, they see it. Nah, you know, they see it. The players see it. They see everything. You know what I'm saying? But you know how it is, man. At the end of the day, you know what I'm saying? You could have a million fucking good things. It only take one bad thing 100%. To spoil some shit.
You're absolutely right. You know what I'm
saying? So, and that's what we got to be mindful of, man, because the people that are doing this shit too, man, are fucking adults, bro. These are like 40-year-old men, you know, 30-year-old women. Like, yo, bro, you need to get a motherfucking life, bro. Like, real talk. You know what I'm saying? Let these kids be kids.
Some are accounts of people, like, legit listen to them.
They wilding, man. They wilding the fuck out, man. Like seriously, bro. Like, that should be making – I'd be getting upset. You know what I'm saying? Because I got, you know what I'm saying, a kid playing, you know, college basketball, you know, doing his thing. Had to face a little backlash. I've been through all that shit. You know what I'm saying? I know as a parent, you know what I'm saying, that shit make me want to rip people's head off. But, you know what I'm saying, cooler heads always prevail. So it is what it is. But at the end of the day, man, like, you know, you don't want nobody talking about your kid. You know what I'm saying? And it just seems like everybody's a fucking expert nowadays. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Everybody's an expert. They want to tell John what to do. They want to tell Kyle, you know what I'm saying, he's soft. He can't do this. He can't. Tyrese, you can't do this. You can't do that. Like, that shit is whack, bro. Like, that shit, I don't even know what else to say other than shut your bitch ass up and let these kids play.
Talk to them.
If I may, I've been running the Instagram, the Twitter account that I run since I was in middle school.
And that was only a year ago. No.
Nah, it was. It's been like 10 years, about, which is crazy to think about. But
it's crazy.
I've been running these pages since I was in middle school, and you know, as a college, I was in college the year that Duke had the down year, the 2021 COVID year, and. Oh my gosh, people were coming onto my pages, like, not Duke fans and some Duke fans, and just trashing me, who has no affiliation with the university. Like, I'm a fan. I'm making these posts because I like doing it, and I like keeping people informed and engaging with Duke fans on social media. You know, the people coming out in droves, just like yelling at me, not knowing who I am, like, I'm just a college kid too. I'm not much older than most of the guys on the team. I'm younger than a couple of them, I think. And I know I'm younger than Ryan. Like, you know, this stuff hurts. It hurts me when people come after me. I'm not a player. Imagine how they feel. Like, I can't control this stuff. Neither can they. These kids, like, you know, they're playing their hearts out. They're playing their tails off. They want to do good for the name on the front of that jersey. If you come to Duke, you come to Duke to play for Duke and to win for Duke. I know how it feels to be attacked just because Duke's not doing as well as you would hope they are. It is not a good feeling. Let these kids be. They're kids. Like, come on. Be better than that.
Yeah, AC, you and I go way back, right? We go back to the message board days where, you know, a lot of this stuff is being written, and we've been saying for years that, you know, players read this. Parents read this. Recruits read this. It's all like Pablo said. And the other thing is, you know, the one thing that we do on this podcast, I think better than anybody, and I'm probably biased, but I'm just being honest about it, is that I'm very open about the fact that during games, you know, yeah, I'm upset and, you know, play to play, whatever, but you keep that shit private. You don't go on social media, you don't go on the message boards and start trashing these people because, first of all, they're giving everything they have, and you don't know also, the other part of this that people don't want to admit is that, yeah, okay, well, now they're getting paid, so I have a right to do it. No, you don't. You're not
paying. No, you don't.
You're not paying them. You're not the one paying these kids.
Even if you are, you don't have a right to do that.
The other part of that is there's no ROI for you to say that, other than your self-satisfaction. You know, when you lose a game as a fan, like, your fan buddies can come back at you and talk trash, and that's all part of the game. I'm with that. I'm with that. That's all good fun. I'm cool with that. I'm not dodging that at all, and that's great. But when you're attacking the player's character, when you're attacking the player's, you know, well-being, and, you know, just talking shit to someone that you don't know, that's something that you would never say to their face, then you're just you're a flat-out loser.
Yep. That's you're soft.
You're a loser.
Seriously, man. Like,
yeah, you're soft if you do that.
It's an epidemic. It's an epidemic that's been happening since sports media has kind of changed to talking heads, hot takes, and I need to be right over anything else. And I think that's what we're seeing. I think we're seeing fans who'd rather be right than support their team. And we got enough people who hate us. Like, why y'all want to add to that? But if you do, I'm not gonna tell you how to be a fan. Go do it. I think the jury's out on if some of the negative talk on Twitter costs you a recruit or costs you a player. I'm the jury's out on it. Broad sweeping. I know of some examples. I know of some examples of where that has cost, you know, somebody. But there's a smaller school, some other shit. But at a place like Duke, you get used to it. You know what I mean? However, at a place like Duke, there's so much pressure. These kids are already under so much scrutiny, and like we're saying, they see this stuff, man. And why add to their bad day, man? Like, we know Flip is not playing great right now. We know he's feeling something right now. Like, it's obvious. Like, why do you want to add to that? Like, sometimes all it takes is somebody to just burn some toast in the morning. They're gonna flip the fuck out that day. Like, what are we doing, man? Like, why do you want to make somebody's life miserable? Like, that ain't cool, man. So that's all I would say is just
why are you rooting for them?
Right, to fail. That's my question is. Like, why are we rooting for our own team to fail?
I'll never understand it.
I'll never fucking understand it.
It's what I'm saying.
It's loser behavior. It's loser mentality.
They would rather be right. They would rather be right. That's people saying that.
Like, the 5-point play mantra is you'd rather be right.
They'd rather be right. There's still people saying they don't want Jeremy Roach to come back next year if he has a year. Like, Jeremy Roach has a year, he can come back next year, and people are still saying they don't want him to come back. Why?
And that's fucking crazy.
I would welcome him with
a call. I do
want to finish.
I'm done.
Yeah, I want to finish with this, is that, like, that Jeremy Roach thing is the best example. Because I remember earlier this year, the example between him and Quinn Cook. And the example, you know, on his face, and you're like, oh, well, the players are different. Actually, it's identical when you really think about the way the fans treated both of those players. And, you know, they were trash for 3 years, and then all of a sudden they're gods. Because, you know, that's the way they wanted it to happen. And the other thing is that for years, you talked about how, oh, Coach K team peaked in November and they peaked in December. And that was it. And so you were willing to give up a few wins in November and December if it meant that your team was trending and developing. Well, now you're getting that and you're still trashing them. So who's the problem? It ain't Duke. It ain't John Shire. It ain't Coach K. It's you. You're the fucking problem. Pablo, Panthers out of here. I'm done.
Yo, like, I want everybody just on some, like, I ain't gonna go crazy, like, on some calm shit, right? Go read that tweet again by David Bradley, bro. He's tweeting that shit for a reason. Really read it. Read into that shit. And pay attention to what he's saying. At the end of the day, y'all fucking up, man. Y'all really fucking up. But as always, bro, 5-point play, man. We do this shit. You know what I'm saying? Go Duke basketball. Let's go Duke.
Let's go Duke.
Thank y'all for tuning in. Check us out on Patreon, Instagram. You know what you're going to get from us. We're on Discord. We're on Autograph now. You follow Autograph. You get your podcast from there. We're on Autograph now. We're everywhere. We're everywhere you want us to be.
Yeah. Use my code JDuke at sign up on Autograph. We got some cool stuff coming there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. 5-point play podcast. Let's go Duke.
Go Duke.
Go Duke.
Go Duke.